we'll get started here because I know your time is valuable and I want to respect that you have other items on your agenda today. And I appreciate that you took some time today to join us. Again, today's session is on attracting and retaining staff in childcare centers. And it is one of the most difficult times in childcare to be able to both retain staff and get new staff in. There is that childcare shortage out there, and it's not just you that is struggling. It is across the industry, and it's not an easy fix right now. So we'll talk about, you know, think about some of the things that we're doing in our centers right now that maybe you are able to make some changes to, and some other things that you can do as you're looking to hire staff to make your program more attractive. So just want to introduce myself. My name is Cynthia Parker. I've been in the early childhood field now for over 28 years. I have been a teacher in early childhood. I have been a director. I have worked in the home office of a large childcare company here in Massachusetts. I have been coaching and part of different projects for the last several years. So I've been in your shoes in that spot of hiring and trying to get teachers in. I can tell you that I remember when I had my first child, and she's now 23 years old. I remember when I was returning to work, I was the director of a school, and I couldn't bring her into school with me at 7 o'clock because we didn't have the staff. So my husband used to bring her in at 8 o'clock because that's when we had that next person that allowed us to meet ratios to drop her off. So again, as a parent, I felt that. As a director, I felt that. It's not easy. There's a lot of juggling that goes on when we're trying to staff and then schedule everyone around different children's hours and making sure that we're maintaining ratios. So again, I'm coming here today with experience on this. I wish I had a magic wand to make it all easier. Unfortunately, I do not. But again, there are some things to do that we can make sure that we are being more attractive to people who are looking for a job. So in today's session, we're going to be looking at, first of all, let's identify why employees are resigning. All right, what are they telling us is their reason for resigning? Is that the case? Are these things that we can, you know, make some adaptations to? We'll also talk about how to attract and retain high quality staff. And lastly, selecting the right candidate for your team, because it's not always about, you know, just pulling in the first person who says they're willing to work for us. If they're not the right fit, they can bring down that morale and change that image of our school. And we don't want that. We want to make sure that we're maintaining a high quality level of professionalism, both to the other staff in our school, as well as to the families who are coming to us. So this is a report done by NACI a couple of years ago. They surveyed about 7,500 early childhood educators. And what they found as some of their results were that 4 out of 5 childcare centers reported staffing shortages. I mean, 4 out of 5, that's, you know, 80%. They also noticed that low wages was the leading cause for either attracting and retaining staff. And we all know that money isn't everything, but, you know, it is difficult out there. We do need to pay our bills. And so sometimes staff do not want to leave us, but they have to, because again, paying their bills is a requirement to stay in their home, to pay for their own children's programs that are needed, to cover our car bill, and, you know, much, much more. What also was noted that was because of the pandemic, programs were running at about 71% of licensing capacity, with only about 49% of children attending daily. So we don't have the staff, but we also aren't getting the children. So that's another struggle, because in order for your programs to run, you need that childcare tuition to come in so that you can pay your bills. And then lastly, 1 in 3 childcare owners considered closing the program during the pandemic. And so first of all, I applaud all of you who have been able to stay open and willing to stay part of the childcare industry over the last few years with the pandemic, because it has not been easy. You have all been frontline workers. Families have needed you, and you have stayed there to make sure that you're meeting their needs. And a lot of that has to do with the love that you have for what you do. All right. So wondering, here's the first question. Why are teachers resigning? So I'm going to try and just get a poll up here. And I'd like you all just to answer. It's a multiple choice. You can choose as many as you like for the responses. And I'm just going to launch this right here and just give you like 30 seconds or so just to fill this in. And I think we've got everyone. So let's take a look at these results here. I'm going to share the results of what you all are experiencing out in the field. So results are saying that 78% of you are hearing that pay is one of the main issues why teachers are leaving your programs. 22% are saying hours. Okay, so that could be hours because they need particular hours, could be the hours of your school, again, isn't matching what they need for their personal life, or again, just the flexibility they need. 56% are saying that there are family needs that they have to attend to in order is why they need to leave. 44 are saying that it is medical. And I do want to note that within medical, there's mental health that we have to consider. There are a number of studies that have reported, you know, just the increase in stress and mental health challenges that teachers are facing because of the pandemic. And some of them are leaving for that because they just aren't able to handle that right now. It's too much. 33% say that teachers are telling you they're leaving the field altogether. They're done with childcare, they're moving on. And interestingly enough, nobody clicked other. So we seem to have nailed those top five then. But similar to what NACI found, pay seems to be one of the number one reasons as to why teachers are leaving the field. And the difficult thing is we can't always pay teachers more. We might be able to look at our budgets and find ways to realign some of what our budget line items and pay teachers more, but payroll tends to take up 60 or 65% of what your incoming tuition is. And that's a lot because you still have to pay for other things like your rent or materials and so forth. So sometimes you don't have that wiggle room. So pay might be one, but we want to also make sure that the environment and the other options that you can provide to children are valuable for them. So again, we know salary is number one. As I mentioned in medical, teachers are leaving for physical and emotional stress. The pandemic has just done a number on our staff. And I'm sure you all know because you're still here, you've made it through the last few years. And I'm sure the stress, both physically and emotionally on you, has been, you know, beyond what you've experienced before. Another reason, as we mentioned, poor work-life balance. Work-life balance is something that's, you know, really promoted in many companies, you know, trying to make sure that there's flexible schedules and, you know, employees have time for families. But in childcare, we are really driven by ratios. So if we have the children there, we need the staff there. We can't just easily say, oh, take off at 2 o'clock. You can have, you know, Monday, Wednesday, Friday at 2. When you don't have someone to fill in for them and your ratios aren't being met. So again, it can be tricky for us. There can be a lack of advancement as well, because if you're a smaller childcare program, whether you're a single school or just have a couple of schools, there might not be a place for teachers to go. So if they want to advance to some level of leadership position or become a director themselves or open up their own childcare center, they have to leave to do it. Also, that disproportion between education requirements and pay. So, you know, many states, along with NACI, is looking for educators to be qualified in that they have at least a bachelor's degree. But after coming out and completing a bachelor's degree, the pay is just not there for that work and effort that people have put into the bachelor's degree compared to other industries that are taking in people who have a bachelor's degree. So again, it's just not balancing out for them. So, you know, we have a lot of things that are, you know, are up against, you know, putting us up against the wall. All right. So here's an article I found, and, you know, I thought this was telling because this was a business reporter and he went and interviewed a number of childcare educators, some who are in the field, some who have left the field. And the reality is that early childhood educators love their jobs. They love to be in classrooms with children. They love to engage with families. But here are some of the responses that he received in interviewing these teachers. First here, so here's one quote. She's stressed, exhausted, burned out, and underpaid. Her job has become less rewarding during the pandemic, and she's hoping to find a better way to provide for her two children. All right, so again, somebody loves what they do, but they need to care for their own two children. Somebody else who said, the job that I absolutely love doesn't pay me what I need. Somebody else shared, she was initially expected to work up to 6 hours straight without a bathroom break. This is hard. Now, again, I was a director in a school and I worked in large childcare. It is one of the few industries in which you have to ask permission to go to the bathroom because you need coverage. That's really hard for adults to do. I mean, again, it's really restricting. The requirements that you need and the work that you put in doesn't necessarily match the pay, which is what I mentioned before. There are not enough supplies, no vaccine mandates, and it has been harder to teach things like phonics with masks on. So again, the impact the pandemic has had on us, you know, whether that's that nervousness that a company is not having those high expectations for families and other staff and, you know, regarding the vaccines, I've heard from many, it is so hard to work with children when you're wearing masks. My next door neighbor works with special ed students, and that's a huge thing. You know, when she's trying to work with these elementary students with severe special needs, they can't see her face. They can't understand some of her facial expressions that go along with her message. They can't make out how her mouth is moving to learn how to articulate different sounds. And lastly, the place seems to be hiring teachers that don't possess the qualities and characteristics that an educator should. Again, sometimes we feel like we're forced just to grab anyone who's coming in and says, hey, I'll work here, but they don't meet those qualifications. And in fact, you often see this idea of a sign-on bonus that if you sign on, we'll give you $2,000. But that incentive is not necessarily going to get you who you want, because some people will come on and stay that 6 months so that they can get that $2,000. Maybe it's $1,000 when they start and $1,000 in 6 months. And then they leave because somebody else is offering a sign-on bonus, you know, or there's something better down the street that they want to do, whether it's in the industry or not. And I've also seen companies start on giving bonuses to the people who are with them. You know, so if you work here, you'll get a bonus based on how long you've been here. So recognize those teachers who've been with us for a really long time. Why should someone else come in and get that additional money when you have people who have been really dedicated to you? So, you know, that might be one of those line items that you can shift a little bit. So instead of giving it to income employees, give it to those people who have supported you for so long. So that wasn't to bring you all down. Those are all facts you all know. That's our reality. But acknowledging that is really important because our staff need to know that we relate to them, that we understand that. We don't want to sweep that under the rug and pretend that we don't know that it's more difficult or that they're, you know, putting in those extra hours and it's really, you know, hard on them. We want to recognize that, you know, they're people. We need to connect with our staff. That's really important. So put it out there and talk with them about it and, you know, let them be part of the solution. You'd be amazed what they might come up with. Let's move into attracting and retaining high quality staff. And a lot of what we do can actually do both of these. It can help bring in new staff and it can help retain the staff that we have. Let's think of this as a bit of a puzzle. All right. We need to establish a positive organizational culture, okay? We're going to talk a little bit more about that organizational culture in a second because it really identifies who you are against the competition. We also want to think about building good staff relationships. All right. We may not feel as though we have the time to sit down and have, you know, coffee with our staff, but it can be really meaningful when we give our staff a few extra minutes here or there of our time. When we ask them questions like, you know, how's your mom doing? Or how was your vacation? How was your weekend? Or tell me how your classes are going. Because that relationship, again, is the connection that people are looking for. We're humans and we want to connect. We also want to think about offering strong employee packages. And there might be limitations to what you can offer, but there's also some creative ways of, you know, thinking about what we can offer teachers. We're going to talk more about hiring wisely, what that interview process may look like. And we also always need to think about how we can manage our time wisely. One of the things I remember doing and when I worked in a large childcare organization is I had a pair of directors who were really just struggling. And what I did is I spent a couple of days there and just hung out at their school. And I did my own work, but I kind of watched the goings on at the school. And I noticed that as wonderful as these two directors were, they weren't necessarily managing their time wisely because they let their office door become a revolving door. So people were coming and going and interrupting them all day long, and they couldn't get anything done. All right, let's go into our organizational culture. I do want to say, if you have any questions or comments throughout, please, I did set it so that you can engage in the conversation. So please feel free to. But let's move into organizational culture. So an organizational culture is the collection of values, expectations, and practices that guide and inform the actions of all team members. And so when we're talking about this idea of culture, you know, we're setting ourselves apart. We're saying how we're going to be professional, how we're going to be supportive, what it means to be high quality. How do we respect one another? And how do we bring joy into our organization? And these expectations go for all of the members of our team. They go for ourselves. They go for all of our educators. They go for all of the other staff members who help make your school run. And in essence, it becomes our branding. It becomes who we are, what we're known for. So, you know, people could say, oh, you know, Sunny Day's childcare program down the street. We know that they're XYZ. We know that they put staff first. We know that they have a positive environment for staff and that they have open communication lines. They have some really great practices in terms of, you know, how staff are supported and the ability for staff to be part of decision-making within the company. All right. And your culture, there's not one right or wrong necessarily. Your culture has to be your own, but it also has to be something that you reinforce. You can put a culture on, you know, you write your culture down on paper. You can put it up on the wall in those fancy peel-on, stick-on wall decor pieces. But unless you implement it and you set that expectation that this is how our school runs, does it have any meaning? So as I mentioned, that culture can attract and it can also retain your staff. So if your school has a good reputation because of this culture in which you've established, people are going to want to work at your school. And if you have an organization that is respecting the staff that you have now and you really place value, people aren't going to leave for 25 cents an hour. Okay, people may leave for money reasons because they need to pay their bills. But if they're working in a place that they really feel valued and they really respect and they really feel like professionals, 25 cents an hour is not going to get them what they want in another location, okay? Because there's more to it than that, all right? That's what we have to think about. And what I've found in the past too is sometimes teachers who do leave for that 25 cents an hour, they come back. Because they realize that that's not covering the bills the way they thought it was, and that that new environment isn't bringing them the happiness, is not giving them the professional fulfillment that they want. and they've returned. I've had staff come and go, and they come back realizing grass isn't always greener on the other side. Culture is also an indicator for employee satisfaction. So one of the research beyond childcare has found that 2/3 of employees stay at their job because of the organizational culture, okay? Because it aligns with who they are and where they want to be in life. All right, so 2/3, 65%. So again, if you're struggling, I want you to reflect on your culture, all right? Is this school at the expectation you want to be? Is it providing your children, your families, and your staff what you say it's going to do? I'm going to ask you all, let me jump back there. I'm going to ask you all to share either in the chat box or again, please just feel free to speak up. I want you to share some of the elements that you are very proud of or that you find very important in your organizational culture right now, in your workspace now. But what are some of the expectations you have for yourself and teachers, even for family members, you know, that sets you apart and makes you the high quality valued place? Jennifer raised her hand. Go ahead, Jennifer.
I would like to say that I'm the director and owner of my facility, and I think the thing I've heard most from my staff is that they love how much I value their families as well, because I often tell them, you know, I'm only as good as, for example, if you're a mom or you're a wife, if your husband is dealing with health issues or your kids are dealing with health issues, you're only as good to me as they are to you. So if they're not doing well, I know that means you're not doing well. So I try to look at their families as if they're my own as well. So if their babies are sick and there's a way for us to manage without them being there, or call someone in for reinforcement and give them the day to spend with their families, I think that's the thing my staff will probably say is the most valued part about our organization. We actually care about each other like family, and not just about a worker.
Yeah, I mean, think about it, Jennifer. Thank you for sharing that.
Sure thing.
I'm just going to mute because of the background. Here we are taking care of families. That's what we do, all right? And we want to take care of our own families too in terms of who our staff are. They have families too. And you're right, Jennifer. If our families, if our staff families are struggling, they're not coming to work, you know, ready to give their best, or being able to support the classroom, support their coworkers, and that can be a very negative response throughout the entire environment of your school. So I love that. And, you know, it's just as though, you know, your own family, if you need to stay home with your own sick children, you need to allow other children, other teachers and staff members to stay home with their sick children, or family member, for what it might be. We have a couple other great answers coming in here in the chat box. Gabrielle said, giving teachers time off when they need it. They work 4 10-hour days. All right. Those are long days. In my younger days, and I'm not that old, but I remember living and breathing those 10, 11 hour days in the classroom, you know, and now it's a lot different. If you said, can you stay in the classroom 10 and 11 hours? That's a lot of work. But recognizing that again, you know, thank you so much for working that much, you know, have a very clear time off policy. And when people ask for that time off, you give it to them. Or if it's something really important, you do what you can to find the coverage. Angie says, we're part of a school and our preschool teachers with the same education and experience have the same respect, value, and salary as all teachers pre-K through 12th grade. Wow, that's really impressive. There's been this disparity between pay between early childhood teachers and elementary / public school teachers for years. And the fact that you are recognizing their education and experience, and in return, being able to pay them similar to the public school or the elementary upper secondary school system is really important. And one of the big things at why early childhood teachers will leave the field. I remember I felt as though our pre-K teachers would come to us and get experience until that public school job opened. Like we were a transitioning step for them because it looked good on their resume. It gave them experience, but the public school offered something different that we couldn't. It also says full-time teachers receive one free child and after years experience discounts for second and third. Childcare discounts are huge. We were just talking before this session. I saw something in a report, it was about a month ago, saying that childcare was costing about 40% on average, 40% of families' income. And to be affordable, it should be closer to the 7% mark. Given the rate of pay that early childhood teachers have, they can't pay for their own childcare. They can't afford their own programs that they're working in and so forth. So providing a discount or free childcare is huge. And I know from a business perspective, that is a financial responsibility for you because now you're missing out on this tuition. But again, it will retain teachers because now they can have their children with them, have their children in high quality places. The child will age out at some point. So if you can financially do that as a business, it's amazing. All right. Someone else said, Kristen said, team building monthly at our staff meeting. Get to know the staff wall, offsite events. Sometime I take breaks and I just be present with educators away from the office and no work talk. Beautiful. Again, that's the relationship building. You need to establish a relationship. And I'm not talking about a personal relationship, let's go to the movie Saturday night. It still has to be a professional relationship, but get to know them as people. And you can do that through activities, through things. I'm noting the staff wall and even the breaks. But sometimes when you're covering lunch breaks, be strategic in terms of what room you're covering in, because maybe it's somebody you need to spend a little more time with chatting to get to know them. And again, it doesn't have to be work talk. You can be covering a break if children are napping and just get to know them a little more personally. Let's keep going. So we have this great culture that we're establishing, okay? What we expect of everybody, what we're gonna do ourselves. But staff still need some things from us as a director, all right? They still need that leadership that says you're reinforcing this culture that you are saying the school has. So some of the things that your team needs from you, and some of you recognize this, is just appreciation. And that can be that good morning every day. When they walk in, are you making eye contact in and say, good morning? You know, hey, thanks for coming in early. Or, hey, I noticed the children engaged in that art activity. It was amazing the way you did X, Y, and Z. Those words can go a long way because it says that you're noticing them as individuals. Fair treatment and consistency. And this is really important because if we are letting one teacher off all the time or letting one teacher go home sick early all the time, and we are always told, no, I need you to stay. I don't have coverage for you. That can be really difficult, you know, thinking that there may be some favoritism going on, you know? So when we have these expectations, we need to be consistent across the board with all of our staff. That doesn't mean we can't be flexible, all right? So the way we respond to one teacher may be slightly different to another teacher just because of their individual needs. Just as though we are caring for children, we need to have classroom rules, but we may adjust those expectations a little bit in how we respond to children in our classroom. People are people, and the same thing goes when we're adults, okay? Communication is huge. Teachers want to know what's going on, why things are happening. You know, they don't want to find out 5 minutes before their lunch break that, oh, you're going on lunch. They want to have this information ahead of time. They want to be informed of changes happening in school. They don't want parents to come in and tell them what they learned in a newsletter and they don't know about it. And they want to have some flexibility within the classroom. As a school, yes, you may need to have a particular curriculum program because you have an expectation in terms of some of the learning goals children are going to or should be learning within different age groups. But allowing teachers to have some flexibility and creativity within those guidelines can be extremely rewarding for a couple of reasons. One, the staff get to express themselves. They get to have that individuality. Second, it allows you to really see the strengths of various teachers. Instead of everyone being robotic and you know, implementing the exact same curriculum, you know, you get to see who rises to the top, like who really has a strong understanding of language development, who really understands open-ended art, who really goes above and beyond integrating learning across domains. You get to see a lot of great elements in your teachers. And then for those teachers who may want to move up in the field, you can still empower them within your school to be leaders within your school, even if you can't promote them to something because there's not a next step for them there. But again, we can empower them. Umesh, you actually shared a nice article with me by Warren Buffett. And some of the things that he recognized, and Warren Buffett has an amazing early childhood program established out of Nebraska. I got to go there once a couple of years ago because of some funding a program I am on received, a beautiful, amazing work they do. But he basically said that staff want you to communicate clearly, which we didn't say. They want you to protect them from burnout, which somebody already shared too about providing them the time off. Recognition, so goes along with appreciation, and empower them to make good decisions. So that falls within that flexibility within the classroom. We need to establish some trust that teachers are going to make good decisions when it comes to how they're going to interact with families, how they respond to children, how they respond with coworkers. And here's a great quote that came from that article. You don't need to have extraordinary effort to achieve extraordinary results. You just need to do the ordinary everyday things the ordinary everyday things exceptionally well, all right? You need to be a person first and foremost and connect with your staff. You don't need to do fancy, expensive things or have complicated routines. You just need to do what you do and do it well. And your staff will appreciate and respect you for that. All right, I'm gonna keep going on this. So here's a scenario I want you to think about. Jenny's an average teacher. She's nice to the children. However, she consistently shows up late and asks to leave early at least once a week. Jenny tends to not be prepared with the materials for her lessons that she plans each day, resulting in her taking more time away from her classroom so that she can go gather materials. Parents tend to like Jenny because she's flamboyant and she easily wins them over. And they, in fact, often hire her to babysit for them. So she's got multiple families that she babysits for. What are your first thoughts about this scenario? I'm going to have you just kind of throw some response in the chat box here. You know, given this idea of that culture we want to establish, the needs of our staff, for those of us who are directors, what does this scenario kind of exemplify? Or what could you do as a leader to make sure that staff are all feeling fairly treated? My guess is you've had probably an employee like this at some time. I know I have. You know, it's really hard when you have a teacher that all the families like, because if you were to fire them, the parents would be in an uproar. All right. And she's able to engage those families. She's good with the kids. All right. The kids seem to like her. But again, she's consistently showing behavior that is impacting coworkers. All right. So we have Angie saying, build relationships, help Jenny look at arriving on time, ask her what to do. If she has none, mention the night before to leave 10 to 15 minutes earlier. Angie, what I love about your response here is you're trying to, again, empower Jenny. All right. So you're addressing the fact that coming in late isn't okay. Leaving early isn't okay. What do you need? You know, what do you need to do to be able to be here on time? What do you need to be here all day? Sometimes you have teachers who are just, I need to get up earlier. I got to set my alarm. I realize that, you know, having those conversations can be telling. Sometimes you have to remind them that when you book an appointment for your doctor or for something else, you need to say, I need an appointment after 4 o'clock. But these are some of those difficult moments we might be able to get stuck into. And what I want to encourage you to do is go back to your culture. What is your culture for your school that you are establishing? And you need to reevaluate this with Jenny. Jenny, this is what we expect. Jenny, this is what we need. You know, you're great with the kids. Parents love you, but Jenny, this is how you're impacting other employees. As a result, they have to stay late. As a result, you know, they're feeling frustrated because lunches aren't started on time because you're out gathering information, you know, gathering materials and so forth. You have to set that expectation so that it is fair across the board for everybody. You know, and again, help them problem solve. She might be able to come up with some solutions herself. Sometimes hard decisions have to be made, even during these really difficult times. I think I just posted something that I really liked on social media saying that something to the effect is change can be really hard, but it can also bring you some really positive results. So sometimes, again, making hard decisions can be what you need to get the change that needs to occur. All right, let's keep going. I want, again, be respectful of your time. We talked about employee benefits. So what are the packages that you offer? Some of you may be part of larger organizations or have funding sources that allow for some really rich benefit packages to be offered. So vacation time, healthcare, 401k, childcare discounts, which someone brought up, tuition reimbursement, and opportunities to grow. One of the things, based on what your school can offer, I would suggest help employees understand how this benefits them financially. Okay. Sometimes, especially if you have a younger population of teachers, is they're only seeing their check number. They're not realizing that you're offering a really good health plan that only costs them, you know, half of what they may get somewhere else. So when you take that into account in their check, what that would look like if they were to go somewhere else. Younger employees don't always value a 401k. My son, he's a senior in college and the job he just started offered him 401k. And I said, Christian, even if you can put $5 in a week now, you know, that may seem like a lot to you right now, but you know what? In 40 years, it's going to make a huge difference. You know, trying to help them understand financially how these employee benefits help them. So this culture, this benefits package, this idea of you as a director and what you want to see in your teacher, this becomes your advertisement, all right? This becomes your selling point. This becomes who you are known for, what you are known for in the community. And so when you are looking to hire new staff, you want to put this into your advertisement. You want to let them know that you're looking for teachers that are going to be collaborative, that have, again, a degree, that are supporting your pedagogy. You're going to tell them a little bit about you, that you have this great benefits package. I know you only get a little bit of space in some of these ads on Indeed and so forth, but you want to let them know, this is what I'm looking from you, and this is what I can also provide you. Because hiring is a two-way street, okay? It's not just about the person coming in. They also have to bring something to the table for you. If it's the right candidate, you want to be really thoughtful about the questions that you ask them. It's easy to get kind of sidetracked in comfortable, casual communication with them that sparks up during a conversation, and that can be really telling. But again, go back to your culture, go back to your school's culture. And how do you ask questions that reflect whether this candidate is going to be a right fit for you? think not only of textbooks answers that they can give you, but think of scenarios. You know, maybe you have a child in your classroom that is struggling with aggressive behavior, and you know this information about, you know, them, about their family, about an IEP, etc. How would you respond to this child in the classroom? What are some things that you would do to support this child? Now they have to really not only just give you back general information, but apply it. And that's what you want from educators coming into your school. You don't want them just to know, you know, Piaget and Vygotsky, which are important, but how to take that information and apply it so that they can support children in the school. Another question you might think of in your culture, maybe you have a beautifully diverse population of families and staff in your school. So maybe a question is letting them know, we have this great diversity within our school. I'd like to know how you establish a community within your classroom that really reflects the diversity and honors and reflects the equity, establishes equity within your classroom, really honoring all of the families in your classroom. That's a tricky question, because again, someone might say, oh, we have, you know, a multicultural potluck dinner on Fridays, the, you know, of each month. Well, that's a moment, but we want to know how each and every day families feel as though they are welcome and they are an equal part of the community that you're establishing in the classroom. So again, go back to your culture and come up with the questions that are going to make sure that you're getting the answers that tell you this is the right candidate. Okay. Now, also streamlining your hiring practices. I can only imagine that some of your schedules are just back to back, you know, in terms of parent tours, teacher interviews, classroom meetings, payroll, etc., on top of covering in the classroom, meeting all of your state regulations in terms of paperwork and other requirements. So thinking about how you can make this process go a little bit more smoothly during the hiring process. Some of the tricks that I know I've used myself and some of the other directors that I've worked with over the time is, first of all, again, really scan applications. All right, think of that culture, what you're looking to have in terms of who in your program, and is it reflected in their application? Do they have those keywords in there that are telling you this person, you know, is giving me information that lets me know that they're a match? Second, start with a phone interview. To bring someone in for a full interview is a lot of time for them. It's a lot of time for you. And if they're not the right fit, you shouldn't have to go through all of those steps. So start with a phone interview, ask them a few of the basic questions. And if that goes well, then bring them in for a full interview. As I mentioned, choose the right questions that really dig deep and have them stay for a working interview. Because again, if you have staff that you trust, they can give you feedback on a possible new candidate for your program. Let them tell you what they noticed during more of a natural situation. And again, sell them on your program, because if they're a great candidate, you want to make sure you get them. So tell them everything you have for them. Tell them about your benefits package. Tell them about you as a director and how you support them. Tell them about your school culture and what a day in the life of being a team member in your school is all about. And again, how do they respond to all of this? All right. So are they a match to your philosophy? Did they have positive interactions with the children? Did they share information that gave you a positive impression? Again, does it match your organizational culture? Now, as I mentioned, finding a way to fit this all into your day can be really, really difficult, okay? And there are different systems that you can also use out there to make life easier. You know, how you're organizing your information, how are you keeping track of all of them? Well, iCare, I just want to share with you too, that a program like iCare can help you find more time in your day. Because if you have a program like iCare, iCare can help you organize all of your accounting in terms of billing parents, you know, identifying where parents might be behind, updating rates. You also have these systems that can streamline communication with parents and staff. Remember, staff want to be communicated to, and iCare can let you shoot off those emails to them, share a staff schedule with them, in everything in a timely manner without taking you a lot of time. It can help you actually do the scheduling, so you know exactly how many children are coming and going in your program each day and in each classroom, therefore identifying the ratios that you need to meet. So it can make your scheduling a whole lot easier. And I've done it as a paper and pencil version before, and it takes a long time. And again, it can also help you manage all of those documents that the state requires. So iCare gives you this one point to sit down in your office and get lots of tasks done within this one system in a very convenient and quick manner. And if you can find more time in your day for all of these other little things, you know, that adds up. It gives you more time to get into the classroom, more time to talk to your staff, more time to find ways to recognize them. And isn't that what we all want? Wouldn't you all love a little more time in your day? So something to think about. And if you're interested, we have a few ways that you can get a hold of iCare. Please feel free to check out our website. Give us a call, shoot us an email. You can see that we're available Monday through Friday, 9 to 7, closed on the weekends. But again, contact us and let us tell you a little bit more about our product and how it can help you find few more minutes in every single day so that you can be the best supervisor possible. I wish you all a wonderful day and an amazing summer.